So, good morning. We are going to talk today about a completely different type of optimization algorithm. This comes under the population-based methods. So, we so far talked about point-based methods, where one point moves to another point, moves to another point. Now, we will be talking about now a completely different type. Yeah. Okay. So, there are many different methods based on the population concept, but we will mainly concentrate initially on the evolutionary optimization. So, to build up the motivation for why we need to do evolutionary, because we see around us a lot of optimal solutions around us, right? And if you look at what's happening, how are they optimal, or how are they even a very efficient algorithm, there are principles that are followed by nature, and one of the things that we know is the Darwin survival of the fittest principle as a guideline from by which the evolution had taken place over the years. So mainly it's a guided search procedure, and there is, if you look at in a very macro way, there is a population that moves to another population, that moves to another population like that, and moving from one population to another, there are a number of operators that acts on the current population in order to create the new population. So they're usually the recombination, duplication, mutation, some of those things. So you have an existing population of individuals, then they are changed to a different population by some operators that are applied on them. And then there is a selection mechanism. The good solutions stay and thrive, have more copies like them, and the bad solutions cannot survive, die off. So that actually provides the nature, the direction for going towards better and better. So what I did is I did a very simple experiment to convince you that if you have a guidance in such a search procedure, you can actually get things very quickly. If you don't have any guidance, then it's very difficult. So what we did in this video that's going on is that on the left side, we have, so we want to build this word IITK, and by using four blocks, one on top of the other, and you are blindfolded, so you don't see what you are building, but you get a feedback after you built it, made all four, and you ask for a feedback. On the left side, we give you a feedback whether it's correct or not. One word, yes or no. Okay, it's a binary option. So there is not much information, not much guidance that we are providing you. We're just saying if you've got it correctly or not. And on the right side, I give you some more information. Like if you've got the first letter correct, I will tell you that only first letter is correct. Or if the third letter is correct, I will say only third is correct. Okay. So if we then start, when it starts, you'll see that they're starting from the same configuration, but the right-hand side is much, much quicker. So they're starting together, and you see as you are generating, you are freezing the information that on the right side. And then in about 40 iterations, we can create this four-letter word. But the random search takes forever. We ran up to about 150 iterations and still didn't converge. You can compute how much iterations on an average it will take before it converges, because there are 26 letters. So you can figure out how much it's going to take. But the point I'm trying to make here is that some people think that there is nothing like survival of the fittest or the evolution. But if there was no guidance in the whole process of evolution, we would not have been here so far, okay, since the beginning of the universe. Okay, so the guidance actually narrowed down the search space, okay, and then it helps to get towards better and better solutions. So this whole process has not converged to the optima. This is a problem which is highly multimodal and dynamic. All kinds of complexities we talked about is there. Okay, there is no fixed optima. So we being the humans, cannot be said as the most efficient solution to this problem. It depends on the environment, depends on what other species are there, because it's after all a co-evolution. And then that environment which is changing. So it's a changing problem, which means an optimization problem that changes with time. That kind of problem you're talking about. So this process of optimization goes on forever, because your problem is changing forever. So nature is solving a much more complex problem than we are solving in design and engineering. But the idea here came about around 60s to some people that why can't we mimic the whole natural evolutionary process on a computer to solve artificial optimization problems, right? So that's what we're going to be talking about. And the reason what we want to do this is because we see around us lots of efficient and optimal solutions. Like, for example, if you take the beehive, okay, the hexagonal shape of beehive can be proven as an optimum. For my semester-long optimization course, I actually give this as a little project where you can take any regular polygonal shape, starting from triangle to higher up, and show that if you want to have the weight versus the strength, weight divided by the strength, and you want to find the minimum solution, that's going to be the hexagonal shape. Okay, it's not octagon, it's not square, it's hexagon. So the question then is, how does bees know about it? Because they don't know mathematics, right? Because for you to solve that, you need to use first order optimality conditions, okay? By writing down the formulation of the problem, then use the optimality condition, then hexagon turns out to be the optimum. But they don't know all that calculus, right? How do they solve it? Okay, there are other ways of solving optimization problems as well, right? So if you are blindfolded or thinking about only improving from your current solutions, you could do it many different ways. You can go through the gradient route, or you can say, I'm going to look around me, I'm going to perturb myself, what my current solution, I'm going to perturb and whatever solution I find is better than what I am, I'm going to move to it and still perturb there and continue to do that. That could be another optimization process without the use of gradient, right? So maybe the natural systems have been doing that, have been experimenting, but then you need few properties of such algorithms before you can call this an optimization algorithm, right? So we are going to look at in a very bare minimum of what is needed from this whole complex evolutionary process. What is the basic things, the basic constituents that you need in order for you to construct an algorithm. Similarly, bamboo trees. I mean, why I'm calling these are optimal? Those of you who studied mechanical and civil engineering would know that there is a concept of buckling, right? So if you have long, slender member, because of a compressive load that buckles, like if I take a paper, so it's a very flimsy thing, right? So if you put a lot of force on both sides towards this and towards that direction, if I force, it can take that load. See, it's not tearing at all. I'm putting a lot of force. I have to really put much more force before I can tear it off. Okay, you can come. That's it. But please try to come in time so that, you know, we can start in time. But take the same problem and let's try to do the opposite. Try to put a force in the compressive side. What happens? You see? Little bit of force and it's buckling, right? This is called buckling. It cannot take the load in a compressive manner. So in engineering, when people are dealing with long, slender members, they always take care of this. This becomes the governing situation or more critical situation. So bamboo trees, they're long and slender, right? So because of their own weight, there is a compressive load, and unless the stiffeners at a range of about 1 foot, if they were not developed, then on its own weight, it would have just broken. Okay, so nature has figured that out. And if you ask your mechanical engineering friends, how do you compute how much would be the length? It depends on the thickness and the length slenderness ratio and the Young's modulus of the material that you have. There is a complicated formula you have to use to figure out whether it's enough or not. This length in which you do these stiffeners is enough or not. Again, how does nature know? It must have experimented in the beginning, and it was all failing. It was not able to get taller, but it wanted to get taller in order to get more sunlight and all that. So it figured out that if I put some stiffeners at every feet, then what happens is my calculation restricts within that feet. So my length becomes only a feet because I provide the stiffener. Now it can have a very thin thin thickness and grow like that. So all these have not come in one day, okay? Nature had experimented, and ultimately what we see now are very close to optimal solutions. But I am not saying they're optimal because it's a problem where optimize changing every time or every day. So nature has to constantly work towards getting better and better. Similarly, you know, penguin body is a nice drag reducer. There are some labs, there are some departments, I'm not sure if you have anything like that in India, but a department called Bionics, where people there go and observe biology or nature of how a similar problem has been solved in nature. and then they get motivation from it, come back to their lab and design an artificial system. So there are a lot of such design we see in nature where we have already mimicked that process, or there are still a lot of things that can be mimicked. So the whole process has some kind of efficiency in it, some kind of optimization in it. So if you can learn the whole process, maybe we can come to computer and make a code out of that. So this thing started many years ago. I'll give you a rundown of the history of when it started and where it is now. But these are called evolutionary algorithms. And then I talked about a little bit of neural nets. So there is a whole literature on artificial neural networks, again mimicking how our brain works with the networks, how it preserves information. And so neural net is an artificial neural net is a way to preserve input-output relationships in a network. And then there are fuzzy systems which are ideal for handling uncertain and not so precise information. Okay? So your variables, instead of being a numeric number, you can say my variable is a temperature, and I'm only talking about 4 or 5 gradations of that temperature, like very cold, cold, comfortable, hot, very hot, something like that, super hot. So you can just have few such alphabetical or verbal way of saying what you mean, and you are not specified any temperature by doing so, but you can do math. So if you say that I have a comfortable temperature and the humidity is not so high, then I can use these two numbers, comfortable and not so high, and multiply it and get something saying, shall I increase the temperature of the room or not? So how much shall I improve by? So all these fuzzy maths are available, and there is a whole group of people who work in this called fuzzy systems. Okay. And in India, we have a big presence of that. In fact, all the three components that I'm talking about have a lot of presence in India and various universities. So people have realized, particularly the work in computer science area, all the three groups come under computer science, but in other engineering also people work on. They realize that there is a common thread that fuzzy, of course, has nothing to do with evolutionary, but the first two, the neural net and evolutionary algorithms, comes from the biological motivation. But fuzzy systems also has a biological connection in the sense that our brain works not with exact numbers, but with such fuzzy numbers. So all these three has some kind of ability to create intelligence, ability to solve difficult problems and also create intelligence. So IEEE has recognized this many years ago and called these three groups together as a computational intelligence, because everything involves computations. So we call ourselves working in computational intelligence field, CI. CI is the broad umbrella. There are three things, but I mainly concentrate on evolutionary algorithms. Once in a while, we use neural nets and fuzzy as well. Another name for this is soft computing. Okay, this whole computational intelligence is also known as soft computing. I think in India, it's more known as soft computing rather than computational intelligence. So under evolutionary algorithms, there are various methods, like genetic algorithms, evolution strategy, genetic programming, evolutionary programming. If you look at some of these, it's just, you know, some juggling of words where the evolution comes in, the programming comes in, but that's really all it is, that you do some programming based on what goes on in evolution, right? But one thing to, sometimes I get questions, sir, I've got a problem, shall I use evolutionary algorithm or shall I use a neural net? That's a stupid question, really, because all these have different purposes. They are not competing with each other. They are complementary to each other. So neural network is to model something, is to get a modeling between input data and output data. This is the usual way they are done. There is an optimization process inside neural network, but neural network cannot optimize. Evolutionary algorithms are used for optimization. That's why we are talking in this course, right? Because it's a course on optimization. I'll not be talking about neural nets here. Fuzzy systems are also not solving optimization problems. It's a way to represent your variables, your solutions. So you see, in evolutionary algorithms, we need a model. That's where neural network can come in, can help us. We need variables. And if we don't want to have precise definition, like in robotics particularly, you don't care whether the object is 2.35 meter away and 59.3 degrees towards right. You don't care. As long as it towards your right and it's not far away from you, you can do some math. You can just calculate and say, okay, let me go on the left. So that kind of verbal working you could do, and the fuzzy systems can help you represent those variables. So fuzzy system is used to represent variables which are uncertain and imprecise. Neural networks can help you do modeling. Once these are done, you have to rely on evolutionary algorithms to optimize the system. So evolutionary algorithm to me comes on the top, and when you have modeled something through neural net, that can become your objective function or constraints, and in order to model it, all your variables can be fuzzy. Okay, so you see that they are not competing, right? They are all complementary to each other. Now, when you do evolutionary algorithm, you need not have neural net. You need not have fuzzy systems. If you have a crisp definition of the functions like we are giving you, 2x1 plus 3x2, that's my objective function, you don't need a neural net. You've already modeled it. So you can use that math objective function and work with evolutionary algorithm. If your variables are not fuzzy, like they are definite, deterministic, like x1 and x2, these are numbers, you don't need fuzzy. But in some problems, you may need them. Okay, so then this provides a framework for you to do this. Okay? Machine learning comes under mostly evolutionary algorithm, but it's a problem that is converted into an optimization problem. So it's a learning problem. So there could be some neural net, there could be some fuzzy altogether. So all the three may involve. Or if your definition of the problem is very crisp, then you may not have fuzzy, you may not have neural net, you can straightaway do evolutionary algorithm. But to me, evolutionary algorithm is needed for any of these tasks because ultimately you need to optimize and come up with an optimal solution or learn what kind of pattern is inside. So you don't want to just get any arbitrary pattern. You want to get a pattern that's mostly common. So anytime you have, I want to maximize or minimize something, you have to think of an optimization method. One of the ways to do is evolutionary. But we talked about classical as well. So evolutionary here can be completely replaced with classical methods like the ones we talked about so far. But then you lose some of the liberty and the flexibility that they have, but you can use them. The best way to do is use a hybrid, evolutionary and classical altogether. That's the best way to do, but I just wanted to put this three things differently because I get this question often is which one shall I use, as if neural net and evolutionary are competing with each other, but it's not. Okay, so we'll get to that. First, I need to tell you what is this method.
Can neural net be used as an optimization tool?
No, they use it. There are some papers we'll find, mm-hmm. but they are kind of forcing, because they know neural net, they are forcing neural net to solve optimization problems. But it has to be certain specific structure. You cannot do a generic optimization with neural network. It is not designed to be an optimization algorithm. It is designed more to store the information about input and output. So a neural net has an input layer, an output layer. So input layer means there are lots of input neurons, and each one can be associated with a particular variable. Output neuron can be associated with each of output. So you have a set of data that has input and output in it. So you want to capture the information of, if I give another input, I want to get the right output. So you have to train the neural net with the existing input-output data and store that information. Where is the question of optimization here? But you can now somehow say these outputs are my objective functions, inputs are my variables, and then I do something with the neural net inside so that when I send an input, I not only get the function value, but I get something. It's not an optimum, but I get some optimal behavior of some sort. So that's, in that sense, they have used, but you need to change the neural network concept. How the neural network training is done. But to me, these are like going around and trying to solve the problem. You are better off using an evolutionary algorithm because that's a direct optimization method, as you will see when we discuss this. Okay, so here is a basic structure of an evolutionary algorithm. First, you have the, so there are a lot of flexibilities here, okay? First flexibility is you can choose your representation of your variables. So far in the classical method, we have looked at and talked about some numeric and non-numeric variables as well, right? When we talked about materials and all that. And I told you that if you have material, you have to have a code, right? So it's all numeric if you're doing classical methods. But in evolutionary algorithm, you can also have non-numeric information. So that's what I mean here, a solution representation. How are you going to represent your solution for the GA if the genetic algorithm is one of your evolutionary method that you're trying to do, right? So that's an important step. But if all you have are x1, x2, x3, which means these are numeric numbers, then you just use them as numeric numbers. Or I will show you first that you can actually use a binary coded GS. So you can use a binary string to represent them. So representation is a big thing, but it depends on what problem you have, whether you want to represent it in a different way or just use it directly. So you have that option at least, okay? And then you choose an iteration counter. To be fancy, we call it generation. Basically, it's iteration. Counter to be zero because you're starting our process. Now, the first difference with the classical method, instead of a point, initial random point, you have to supply an initial set of points, which we call as a population. That's why these are population-based methods. So here is a sketch that these black dots could be your initial set of 7 points that you have supplied. And this could be x1, x2 space, okay? Then usually they are created at random, but if you are solving an existing problem and all you are looking for is to improve the performance, then you can use some commonly known solutions to the problem as your initial set. Then evaluate each of these solutions for computing function value and constraint values, right? So that's what I mean by evaluate PT, so that you get an idea, is it feasible? If not, then what is the constraint violation? If feasible, what is the objective value? All that information you get from one. So this comes from your problem formulation, because you have the fx and gx, everything worked out. Now that everyone is evaluated, you have an idea which ones are the good ones, which ones are the bad ones, right? Then what you do is check for a termination criteria. So that you need to provide a termination, when to terminate. You have to do that same in the classical method as well, right? If you're not terminating, then do few things. First is use Darwin's survival of the fittest idea. That means choose the better solutions of the population, okay? Let's say these 4 solutions are better than these 3, okay? So what we simply do is choose these 4, or sometimes we make duplicates of them. We don't want to screw up with the population size. So here, there are 7 population members. We are going to keep 7 members for P dash T, but we may make duplicates of the good ones. If this is the best one, I might make 2 copies of it. And if this is an average one or slightly above average, I can give it 1 copy. And these ones are bad, I can give him 0 copies. So that some of these, let's say these 3 have 2 copies each, and this one has 1 copy. So I've got 7. So this is another way of saying the bad ones I have deleted, the good ones I have given more copies, okay? They are clones, actually. So that's the part of the selection operation. How we do it, I'm going to tell you some specific way of doing it, but there are maybe about 50 different ways you can do this, okay, selection. So in the selection process, we have not created anything new, right? Whatever was there, some of them we have given 2 copies, some of them 1 copy, some of them 0 copies. Some of them we can even give 3 copies if we are confident that's a very good solution. So the selection operator decides that. Next, after you've done that, this P dash T is called the mating pool. Okay, because now 2 solutions from the P dash T will be taken in pair, and crossover operation and mutation operations will be applied to that. So this variation operator can be a number of operators over here, which basically says you take these good populations. So P dash T is a much better population than PT, right? Because it doesn't have the bad ones. You are taking them and combining its own members, okay, and creating something new. So this is a creation operation right here in the variation, as I'm calling it. Okay, so the size of P double dash T is also the same size as PT. So these open circles can be P double dash T, which is the same size as this one, 7 members I have created. Now sometimes there can be the identical one, the P dash, one of the P dash PT is same as P double dash T. You apply crossover mutation, but nothing has happened to them. So it can be common, but in general, they're all different. So now you've got a new population, which is this open circle. Okay, this one we call as an offspring population, and PT is known as a parent population. So parent, and then in one iteration, we created offspring. And after you've created the offspring, we need to evaluate them, because we need to know how good are these individuals. Again, objective function and constraints are evaluated. Now we've got 2 times the population size. So we combine them and choose the top half of it, the best half. And that's called the survivor operator. Who is going to now survive? So it's an evolutionary process in which there's an overlapping population. The complete parent population is not diminished in the next generation. Some people from the parent stays, and some new individuals stay. And some new individuals that you've just created, they can be so bad that they get eaten up, they just get deleted. But if you have created something good, it stays, okay? So for example, these two from the parent can come because they may be very good, and this five maybe you've created which is also very good, and these two that you have created are not so good, so they can get eliminated. So this could be my new population, which is pt plus 1. Then you increment the counter t plus 1 and go into the loop. Now this set becomes now pt. So you start here, select from it now the better solutions, that becomes your p dash t. Then again create a new offspring population, evaluate, compare, and this is how it goes. So if everything works well, what you will see is that if you take a representative point of your population, this point is going to approach the optimum. It moves to the optimum, and whatever variance you have, some kind of standard deviation you have of the initial population, you notice that that diminishes as you go towards the optima. So it's a cloud moving towards the optima with the reduced variance. So that's kind of the behavior, dynamic behavior of such a population based algorithm. Yeah, question. P double dash T. Yeah, I'm going to P dash T is not offspring. P dash T is just some copies of the PT.
Okay, so
P double dash T, you are creating new individual. I'm going to show you how to do that. Exactly the same clone. It's exactly the same. So as I said, these four, these three may have two copies of them. Just two identical copies in P dash T, and this one has one copy, and this has no copies. P double dash T is this set, this open circle. This is a new thing, completely new thing. So I have to yet to tell you how to create the new individual. I have not told you that.
And P plus 1 is the combination of that old.
Yeah. So you have 7 plus 7, 14. You create the top 7. You choose the top 7 of it. That becomes your. So it could be that these two are selected from PT, and this 4, 5 are selected from P double dash T. And that becomes a new population. After that, you don't differentiate which is what. All of them will become black, and then you follow the procedure.
So
come back to the loop.
White
oh, man, I'm telling very simple. I don't know why you cannot understand it. How many times do I have to tell? The open circles are the new ones. Do you understand new? These are new individual. And these black ones, the solid ones, are old ones. Okay? Shall I repeat, or is it okay? All right. Okay, so this is the first time you're seeing it, so you may have questions, I understand, but please try to understand my English, okay? I don't think it's too bad, okay? So you need to follow what I'm saying, all right? Okay, so now what happens is, let me be very specific. So this is a very generic algorithm I have provided you. I haven't told you how to do selection, I haven't told you how to do variation, I haven't told you how to do survivor, right? Survivor, I told you that you take the PT and P double dash T and choose the top half. But some people also don't do it this way, I said. Some people may not always choose the top half, okay? There are some reasons. But I don't recommend you to do anything other than that at this point, okay? So keep that. So all I need to tell you is what is the selection operator and what is some variation operators, and how to represent solutions. These are the things I haven't told you. Initialize, again, I mentioned you could do randomly, or you could do based on the problem information. Okay, let's now be very specific, and I try to give you one complete algorithm, which is the way the whole genetic algorithm started back in 1962, okay, by John Holland. I will give you a bit more historical rundown of the whole field, but right now it's good for you to know Professor John Holland, unfortunately, just expired last year, but he had an illustrious career. In 1962, around that time, he thought of this algorithm, thinking of biology and evolution, and he was trying to solve some cellular automata problem. Remember, in early 60s, I mean, obviously, you were not born at that time, but the cellular automata was a big thing. Computer science was just on the horizon, and people were trying to do finite state automaton. And he was one of the champions in this. So he was stuck that he wanted a methodology to create new automata, okay? So he was looking for ways to do it, but wanted to keep it very independent. Then he hit upon this idea of using evolutionary way of doing it. So he gave it a name called genetic algorithm. And then a lot of stuff have been done since his time, but some of these we are going to talk about as we go along. But let's first stay with what he envisioned as one evolutionary method. Actually, he never said the word evolutionary in his book or any of his papers. Evolutionary word came only in about 1991, so a long time after he started talking about all this. All right, so I'm going to take a, because it's an engineering course, so I'm going to take a engineering example to explain to you what happens. So let's say this old can design problem that I introduced in the first class, okay? We have a diameter, we have a height. These are the two variables, right? And I have a cost function which I showed you also, the circumferential area plus the two lead, right? Okay, so if you give me any D and H, I can plug it in here and I can give you the cost value, okay? There is a volume constraint that the volume inside should be at least V. Okay, so V I have to specify, let's say 330 milliliter. So find what is the optimal D and H. That's the problem. And we want to use evolutionary methods to solve it, let's say. And we have decided to use binary coded GA. So as soon as you have decided to binary coded GA, the first step I told you, the solution representation, every variable has to be represented in bits. Okay, so that's how the name binary comes in. Okay, I mean, that's how he envisioned. So we are starting with this. Hardly anybody use binary coded GAs anymore. Okay, there are reasons for it. I will tell you later. But let's stay with this very simple idea. Okay, so it's a binary string. Okay, so let's say I have got 5 bits I want to put for representing diameter, 5 bits I want to put for representing height. Okay, all right. So when I have 5 bits, so this is particularly one string, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, one particular binary string. Can you tell me any other 5-bit string? Yeah, how many such strings are there when you have 5 bits? 32, right? So each place there can be 0 or 1. So there are actually 5 positions, so 2 times 2 times 2 times 2 times 2, 2 to the power 5, or 32 different strings possible. Okay, every string like this can be decoded. Have you studied all this before in some introduction to computing kind of course? Okay, so what is the decoded value of this if this is the least significant and this is the most significant? 8. Why is that? Because this is 2 to the power 0 weight, this one has 2 to the power 1, 2 to the power 2, 2 to the power 3, and that's the only one that is 1, and 2 to the power 4. So 1 times 2 to the 3, that means 8. Is it okay with everybody with this, or do I have to explain further? No? It's fine? Okay. So if I use 5-bit strings, what will be the 0, 0, 0, 0 bit decoded to, string decodes to? All zeros. It'll be 0. And all ones? 31. 31. Okay, so 0 to 31, and every integer, I will have a corresponding string. That's how you get 32 different strings, right? Okay. So as soon as I've decided 5 bits, I only have 32 options for that diameter. Now, the decoded value is an integer between 0 to 31. But maybe you can tell me, no, sir, the diameter, I want to go from 2 centimeter to 10 centimeter, not 0 centimeter to 31 centimeter. That means I need to do some mapping now from my decoded value down to a variable value. So let's talk about that first. Here is that mapping function. So you have the decoded value of the string. So S is that string. So for that particular string, we found the decoded value to be 8, right? Let's say A is 2 and B is 5. So 5 minus 2, 3 divided by 2 to the 5, L is 5, this is a string length. So 3 by 31, 3 by 31 into 8 plus 2. That will be the value of whatever that string represents. And you will be absolutely sure that no matter any of these 32 string you take, it will always lie between A and B. Let me prove that. So the lowest value of decoded value is what? 0, when the string is all zeros. So if you put 0 here, this whole term drops, so you have x equal to A. So all the 0 string maps to A. Let's look at all ones. All ones, what is the decoded value? 31, and this is 31, right? They cancel. I have A plus B minus A. What is that? B. So one extreme is mapped to the lower bound, all zeros string, and all one string, which is the other extreme, maps to the upper bound, which is B, any other string will be mapped in between, because the decoded value will be between 0 and 31, and so we'll have always value between A and B, right? And all these strings, if you go one to the next base string, you will just go to the next point in that 32 points that you have, is that right? And the gap between any two of them is equal, no matter where you go. So this is called uniform mapping. So this is a linear mapping with respect to S, or decoded value of S with X. Is that clear? Now, 32 may not be too many, right? For the diameter, you may want to have 1,000 options. Okay, so how many bits are you going to use? How do you compute that? 10. I mean, that's because the next highest number is 1024. 2 to the power 10 is 1024. But how can you compute that? If I tell you that I want a precision of X, which would be, let's say, 2 decimal places of accuracy. So that means the difference between the two consecutive strings representing the decoded values should be 0.01. Okay? And if you go from one string to its next, what is the change in the decoded value? 1, right? The two neighboring strings have got a decoded value difference of 1. Is that okay? Everybody with me? Here? Okay. So you have a value of 1 here. So when you go from one to the other, how much is the change in X? When I go from one string to its next string, okay, X also I am moving from this point to the next point on the X. So what is the difference between these two X? Can you tell from here? B minus A over 2 to the L minus 1. This quantity, right? This quantity. Because when you go by 1 here, this is the one you are adding, right? So this becomes then the precision in the X. So now if you want 2 decimal places of accuracy, you are going to set this to be 0.01. You know your lower bound and upper bound. You can back calculate how much should be the L. Clear? Absolutely? Okay, I think I have an example here. Say X goes between 2 to 10. That's my lower and upper bound. I have decided to use 5 bit, so that's the information I was giving you. 10 minus 2, 8, divided by 2 to the 5 minus 1, 31, so 8 by 31 times. That's the mapping. So here I'm showing you, if you have an arbitrary S, which is decoded value 11, because 1 plus 2, 3, 3 plus 8, 11, right? So if I substitute 11 here, I get the value of 4.8387. So this string actually represents this real number in my decision space. So I've got a precision. That means if I go to the next one, this is going to be an addition of 0.258, because that is just this quantity. So now if I back calculate and say I want 2 decimal places of accuracy, this value I want 0.01. So what should be the L? So it should be 8, because it's 10 minus 2, 8, divided by 2 to the L minus 1. And if I do some math with it, I find that this comes out to be 9.65, but number of bits has to be an integer. So you go to the next highest one, which is 10. So you need 10 bits to have a precision of 0.01 for a X that goes between 2 to 10. You need 10 bits to represent that. If you want 3 decimal places, this would be much more, right? Okay. So this is how to compute the precision. Let me get back to my original slide here. So now I've got a way. So all you have to do now, for every diameter, you need a lower bound and an upper bound so that you can map everything in between. Then in a GA, you are actually creating a string. You're not creating these numbers. You are creating these binary strings. And then there is a little piece of code where you will be getting the decoded value and then use that mapping formula using the lower and upper bound, and you get the D value. Same thing you do for the diameter. Now, you may specify now that I want 2 decimal places of accuracy. So your code will back calculate how much L you need and that many strings you are going to, that many bits you are going to reserve for D. Similarly, for height, if you say 3 decimal places, you can also compute how many bits are needed with the needed precision, and you have that many. So if you have 5 different variables, for every variable, you find out independently how many bits you need, and then concatenate all of them to get a big string. So here, for example, for 2 variables, if I need 5 bits for D and 5 bits for H, I have a total 10-bit strings that is fed to the GA. So the whole representation scheme now is that I need 10 bits, so GA will randomly create these bits 0 over 1, 0 over 1 randomly. How do you create random bits in a computer? There is a rand function, but what is the physical meaning of it? You can actually flip a coin with probability 0.5. So that means you just flip a fair coin. If it turns out head, you put 1. If it turns out tail, you put 0. In a computer, what you do, you create a random number between 0 and 1. If it's more than 0.5, it's 1. If it's less than 0.5, it's 0. 0.5, you can include either direction. Okay? So that's how you can create these bits. And then once the bits are created, you know that first so many bits are for D, and then you use the mapping. Second, so many bits are for H, and you can do the mapping. Okay? So when I've done that, for D and H, I plug it in here, I get the value, function value 23. And that's what I'm printing here, saying this is its function value. Well, this particular D and H satisfies the constraint. If it doesn't satisfy the constraint, then we have to somehow penalize it or use some other method, which we are going to talk about. Now, one of the things I want to say here is that why are we doing this? Why did Holland think of a string like that? First thing, of course, he was a computer scientist, right? So bits idea comes naturally to them, okay? But there is another big reason, and that is, this looks like a chromosome, is it not? Because what is in our chromosome? It's made out of genes, okay? Genes are again made out of a lot of stuff, but if you just been a macro, a chromosome is a concatenation lot of genes. Each gene is responsible for some feature in us, okay? Your gene controls, some genes of you controls how much height you're going to have, what should be the color of your eyes and hair and everything. Right? So what if that gene is somehow changed during the process? It gets mutated or somehow it's changed. Then your eye color will look different, right? So there is a genotypic change that can cause a phenotypic change in you. Phenotypic means how you look like. Genotypic is in the gene level that you can't see, but that's what's causing the phenotypic changes, right? So there's a lot of biology in it from the chromosome to all the way what we look like, okay? Say, do I have a similar meaning here, okay, by calling them as an artificial chromosome? So first thing you notice is, if I call the whole thing a chromosome, I can say that there are 10 genes. Each of them is a gene. Okay, each gene here can take two values. Like in eye color, there could be lots of gradations, lots of options, more than two. But here, we are restricting only to two options. Either it can be 0 or 1, okay? Similarly, the next gene can be 0 or 1, such and so on and so forth. Now let's consider one thing. What about I tell you that the first gene here is 0? So what are the possible diameters that you can have? What is the meaning of the first gene being 0? Diameter will be less than 8. That means 0 to 7, right? If there is a 0 here, can you get 8 at this position? Sorry, can you get, wait a second. Sorry, 15 or less, not 8. Because this is a 32-bit. So 15 or less. So if you have a 0 here, you can never get 16 here, or 17 here, or 22 here, right? So it's restricted to half the size of the range that you have. So in some words, if you tell me that the first gene has a value 0, I immediately visualize the can being slim cans, like Coke cans, which are small diameter cans. But you tell me, no, the first bit is a 1. Then you're talking about large diameter cans, like biscuit cans, big ones, right? So this sort of like suddenly we're making the can alive and saying there is one gene that can tell you, are you a slim can or are you a fat can? Okay? So that's the kind of meaning from artificial chromosome to what it may look like eventually. So we are making this alive now, okay? But can you do the same thing for this bit? I tell you the second bit, or let's say the last one. Last bit is 0. What does it mean physically?
More than one.
No. It's the even ones. It's the even numbers, like 2. It could be 0, 2, 4, 8, like this. And if that is a 1, that's the odd ones. If some sense, that's also a value that you may care about. So if you're thinking of only 32 options, and you have to have an even numbered diameter, that gene represents that. Whether you get an even or odd, that gene represents that. Now, we could make some meaning, but some ones are very clear, and some other ones may not be so important for solving the problem. But every bit has a meaning, okay? Same is true in our genes also. Certain, there are lots of genes in our chromosomes are useless. They're called junk genes. They are not decoding you to anything. They're just there for a long time. For many, many years, biologists didn't know why they're there. But now they have a good idea why they're there. That reduces the chance of having lethal mutations or lethal crossovers. So they have to have those lot of junk genes we are carrying for many, many generations. So very similar thing here. Maybe lots of genes here are not so important, but they got to be there. So we see that there are certain similarities in meanings, but obviously we are stretching it from there just to have the meaning that if you represent it in a binary way, it gets closer to what a natural chromosome may look like. All right. Now let's continue with the algorithm and let's see what's going to happen. So we talked about the representation. Generation counter is zero. Then we have to create a set of initial strings. Let's say we have created six population members. Why six? Why not four? Why not eight? This has something to do with how much should be the population size for a particular problem. I will tell you some general thumb rules later on, but this is an area where there is, it's not much of a science. It's actually more of a thumb rule based, comes with experience, but there are some mathematical analysis came from statistics, more from a sampling theory point of view. So there's a bit of science, but we usually go with experience over there. A general thumb rule is the population size should be in proportion to the number of variables. So if you have more variables, you should use more size, less variable, less size. So let's say we use six just for the illustration purpose here. So now I create 10-bit string for each of these six solutions at random. So one string, 0101, all that, we create at random. Next one, again random. Next one, another random, right? Then I take the first 5 bits, I get the diameter, second 5 bits, I get the height, and I show you in a graphical form how they look like. And I also compute what is the volume inside, because that's a constraint I have to satisfy. It so happens that out of the six, these four is either have 330 or more volume, so they are feasible, okay? These two are a little special. They don't have 330. I think I use 300 here. They don't have 300 milliliter volume inside. So what I do, I add some artificial cost to the actual fabrication cost, okay? And this cost is in proportion to how much constraint is violated. So this one is 28 milliliter short from 300. So that's the violation of the constraint. I wanted 300 or more, but I got 300 less 28. So I add 28 to this. This one I got 35 milliliter less, so I add 35. But you can use some other scheme. This is like using the penalty function approach, where I have a linear of a bracket operator with the power 1. Okay, so that's the same. And I used r equal to 1 in this case. So it's basically a penalty function approach I'm using. But there I need to set a r, and I need to show the bracket operator whether to do square or not. So all these issues are there. But later on, I'm going to tell you that we never use this penalty function approach. But for this illustration purposes, because it's easier for me to tell you how to add these things. So basically, any feasible solution, I don't add any penalty. Any infeasible solution, I add a penalty in proportion to how much constraint is violated. If I had no violation, I would have had zero here, right? Okay, so the actual fitness, now this is called the fitness now, of this solution is 23, this solution is 11 plus 28, okay? So now I've got the evaluation part done. Now I am checking if I have to terminate. Obviously, I'm starting, so I should not terminate so easily. Now I go and do the selection operation. That's the first thing, right? So how do I do selection? One way to do selection is called tournament selection, okay? It's like, you know, you play games, two teams at a time, and the winner goes forward, like that. So what you do is the six solutions, you shuffle them in a random fashion, like you shuffle a pack of cards. Just shuffle them in a random fashion. So we don't know which is which, okay? So they just randomly put. Now you take the top two and look at their fitness value. Remember, we are minimizing the cost or minimizing the surface area. So which one is better? 23, so I keep the 23, okay. Take the next two, which one is better? 24. These two, which one is better? 26. So 26 is kept. So if I've done that process, come to the end of it, I will only have 50% of the mating pool size filled up, right? To fill up another 50%, what do? we take this and put in another random fashion. Again, we shuffle it, shuffle that pack of population members again. Again, we don't know which is compared with against whom, and then take the top two, choose the better one, and so on and so forth. Okay, fill up the rest half. Okay, so is the process understood? We are just pairing them in a random fashion, and the better one is kept. We have to do it two times because first time we'll get half, and second half, second time it will fill up. Fine. Okay, that's a different thing. Don't get hung up with details, okay? Just, I told you I'm going to give you something better here, but this is just a way I've used the penalty function to show you that these solutions, if I used 11, it would have won against any of them, but they are actually infeasible. So that's why I have to make it worse. To make it worse, I have added some number here so that they are much more than these numbers. Okay, so that's the only precaution I've taken. But later on, I'll show you a more scientific way of doing it, okay? Because I don't like penalty function myself, yeah. Right.
So if it so happens that 11 plus 20 is like pitched against 9 plus 35, then there are new one infeasible solution will continue.
It may. Because if I have, what if I had all infeasible solutions? Mm-hmm. It could be. Mm-hmm. Then all you have are infeasible solutions. So we treat infeasible also. We don't throw them. If they are the only ones available, or out of 4, 6, let's say 4 of them are infeasible, then definitely some infeasible will come. But eventually they will die off, okay? But try to understand the whole procedure here, okay? Now, in that process, what have we achieved? I look at it, my original population, and I see 23 has got 2 copies here. Is that a magic?
Yes.
Magic. Or not?
Depends on the random.
Depends on the random, how the selection is done? Everybody agrees? Who doesn't agree? Yeah? So? So the fact that it has 2 copies, is it a magic, is it a fluke, or it will always happen?
At least for the best solution, it will be always.
23 is the best solution now in this population. So it will always happen. So that's not a magic. That's not a chance. It doesn't depend on who is compared with what. It is the best, no matter with whom you compare, it's going to win anyway. So you are always going to have 2 copies of your best solution, for sure. It's a 100% chance. 100% chance, there is no less than 100% probability here, right? It's a deterministic event. How about the fact that 44 doesn't appear here? Also a deterministic event, right? So these two extremes are deterministic events. We want to make sure this happens, that the best one we never lose. We've got 2 copies, and the worst one we're going to immediately lose. We want to immediately lose, so we don't have. How about 24 seems to have 2 copies?
Random.
Now it can be depending on with whom it's being compared. So if 23 is compared with 24 in any of these things, then one time it will not come. But what is that probability? If I have 100 members here, 100 population members, what is the chance that the second best will not have one copy, will have only one copy, not 2 copies? Very, very small chance. It's actually 1 over 99. It's almost 1% chance of having that. Yeah, there is a very small event probability of that's happening. If it's unlucky that both times it's compared with the best one. But that is 1 by 99 times 1 by 99. So it's like 1 by 10,000, almost 10,000. So that's unlikely to happen. Very, very unlikely to happen. So we make sure with probability we are supporting of what we want to do. But many students ask me this question, sir, why are we doing in this complicated way? Why not we take these three, the top three, and make 2 copies each and be done with it, right? So we take 23, give 2 copies, 24, give 2 copies, 30, give 2 copies, that's it, and remove the next half. We could do that. That's a deterministic method. Yeah, all these problems are there, but One thing we don't want to do is deterministic. So as soon as, that's the problem with the classical method. Somebody thought of steepest descent method, that if we go along the negative of the gradient, locally speaking, that's the best direction to go. As soon as you have decided that deterministically, there will be some situations where that's a bad decision that you have taken, particularly if you have local optima and global optima. local information is bad for global. Or it could be a unimodal problem, but currently the local direction takes you in a wrong way or rather circuitous way to get to the global, to the optima. So you may not want to fix your algorithm beforehand. I call them as you are acting like a god in that case. You are deciding what to do at every generation, every iteration. These kinds of methods have stochasticity. Sometimes you can lose even the second best one, both copies. Very small probability though, we want to keep. But there is some chance you can lose it. It could be a good thing if you lose it. Maybe it's a, now you are at a wrong place. So losing the good ones currently may be good for the overall algorithm eventually, right? So we keep these as probabilities. Every event is a probability, but certain things we don't want to fiddle with, like the best one, I don't want to give it any chance. At least two copies I want to keep at every generation. So this mechanism is a nice way you are having good aspects as well as some stochastic aspects in it. So probabilities are used in all the operators of evolutionary methods, but calculated probability. It's not a random, you cannot say it's a random search. Am I doing a random search here? What would be a random search operator? Can someone tell me if I replace this with a random search operator, what would be that? How would I change this method so it becomes a random search? Yeah, yeah. So if I were here, out of 23 and 30, I would take one at random. In this, I will take one at random. That will be a random search. No, I'm not doing that, right? That way, I don't have any direction. That way, I may not have even 23 any copies, and all the bad copies will be there. I don't want to do that random, okay? But it is not a random search method. Many people look at that we are using random numbers, and they think it's a random search method, okay? But it's not. So what happens is, from these population, we get this population where 23 has two copies, 24 has two copies, and 30 got one copy, 26 got one copy. Out of this is the task of the selection operator. Now, is this clear to you that these are not new members? These are some copies of them, more than one, and or one, and some of them have zero copies. Okay, so that's the whole purpose of selection. Nothing new has been created yet. Now we go for creation mechanism. But before we move, is there any other question? One thing I want to say, sometimes we want to give a high selection pressure. This is called the selection pressure, like I've got two copies of 23. What if I wanted to give a little more selection pressure for the best, three copies of 23? How would I change this method? So I want to get eventually three copies of 23. Yeah, so I'm being more greedy in that case. So how do I change this operator?
The tournament will be between the best and the other.
No, but then the second best can also have three copies. Yeah, we can what? Well, the simple way to change would be instead of two, I take three and keep the best one, right? And then this three, keep the best one. Then I have to do two more times like that. And then every time 23 will win, so I will have three copies of it. If you want four, you take four at a time. So you can keep on doing it like that, okay? I want to have 1.5 copies. How do I want to do this? What does it mean? If I want to have 1.5 copies of 23, on an average, I want to have 1.5 copies. How do I do this? So one simple way to do is have a binary tournament. This is called binary tournament because two are used. But don't choose 23 all the time. You choose the better one with a probability 0.75. And 0.25 probability, you choose the worst one. That way, sometimes you'll have one, sometimes you'll take the better one, sometimes you'll not take the better one. On an average, you'll have 1.5 copies, okay? We hardly use that, but this is a flexibility that you have here. Okay, now what are the variation operators? Okay, now we take from the mating pool two at random, two solutions at random. Just make sure that they are not the same. They are not the same. Just take two of them at random. So 23 and 26 maybe. Now we go and look at this chromosome, at their string. Okay, with 10 bits, I have got 9 sites, intermediate sites, right? To crossover operator, GA does not differentiate that this is diameter, this is the whole string to it. GA looks at it as a whole string. And now you choose one of these 9 sites at random. So let's say I've chosen the third site here at random. I could have chosen this site, I could have chosen that site, okay? Now after you've chosen that, it divides the string into 2 halves, right, 2 parts. So you now create the first child by taking the left part of the site from first parent and right part from the second parent. So this gets attached to this and I get that. And this gets attached to that and I get this. Okay? So that means I've got 2 new strings. This is a creation mechanism by which you create offspring. And this is exactly how it goes on in natural chromosomes. But it doesn't happen in one point. Actually, in our chromosome, there are multi-point crossovers. This is called a single-point crossovers. So you also have multi-point crossover. You could do a 2-point crossover. When you do 2-point, you'll be choosing 2 sites, and all the bits that are between the 2 sites is swapped, and the site remains the same. Okay, so 3-point you can continue, 4-point you can just keep on doing it. Okay, so by that process, you've got something new. You can be lucky like this, right? Or you can be unlucky as well that you create something bad. We don't take care whether you are creating good or bad or not. But if you look at the chance of creating better ones, there's a very good chance. Why is that? Yeah, because these are good solutions, came after selection. So they are good. They are at least compared to another solution, it turned out to be better. Now, why is this better? I don't know. It could be that 0-1 combination here makes the diameter small in a range close to the optimum. That's why this is better. Why is this better? It could be the height here. These 2 combination is good, that's why it is better. So now when I have the crossover, I can put both of them into one. This is the only operator in the all optimization algorithms that I know of. It's unique. It's no other algorithm has this kind of feature, that properties of 2 different solutions can be put into one by this operator. This is the main search operator of evolutionary methods. This provides you the speed at which it approaches the optima. You are taking properties of good solution, combining it into one, and that's your new child, right? But none of this is checked while we are doing. So sometimes we may be not creating very good solutions, but fine. What happens if you have not created a good solution? You don't have to carry it long. In the next iteration, the selection will screen it out. But what if you have created something good? Now it will get 2 copies in selection. So it has 2 such chances to mate. Right? So its chance of creating solutions like it or better getting more and more. That's exactly what goes on in nature. If a species has slight advantage over its peers, it's going to survive a bit longer. It can hide from the predators more time than its other peers, so it will not get eaten up. So if it survives longer, it can reproduce more like it. And that's the direction in which so fast the evolution has taken place. I don't know why people who don't believe in this, what do they believe in? I mean, obviously in the US, about 30% people don't believe in evolution. And they have a different viewpoint, mainly coming from religious beliefs. But it's just that. But then if you look at the scientific way of looking at it, it makes perfect sense to me. But then if it's posed to you saying, this process, how can it create as complicated object like I, for example, or anything that you see in us, it's so complicated. Just by taking out the bad ones and good ones, can you do all these? Yes, if you give it time, you can. Okay, it's not that humans were created in one day, right? It's a lot of iterations, trying and all that. But there was a strong guidance for anything better will survive and create like it. So all these are captured in this selection and crossover new operator. Okay. I'll come back. Just let me finish this. Next one is after you've created the offsprings, then you need to mutate, okay? So what you do is take one of those strings that are created after crossover, like for example this one, and you go and perturb a 1 to a 0 or a 0 to a 1, okay? So for example, this one is changed to a 0 suddenly, and then you got another string. It depends on now a probability called mutation probability, okay? So usually this mutation probability is kept very low. Mutation is a individualistic operator. It doesn't depend on more than one string. It's just one string, you go with it. So the way it does is called bitwise mutation, where every bit you flip a coin with probability Pm. Okay, if it turns out true, you change it to its complement. If not, move to the next one and create another random number, check with PM, and like that you do. So usually we fix the PM in a way so that only one out of the whole string, one bit will get mutated. So you don't want to do too much. If you do with 50% mutation, then it's a random search again. So you don't want to get close to the random search. I forgot to mention, this crossover also is done with a probability called PC, crossover probability. And this is usually kept very high because this is our main operator. So if I keep PC equal to 0.8, that means 80% of such pairs will get mutated. 20% will not get mutated. So what does, I'm sorry, crossed over. So what does it mean, not crossover? So you just simply take these two and put it here. Like, it's just passed on. There is no crossing over done.
23 and
26. Yes, same thing will go. 20% of the pairs will just go like that. 80%, you choose a cross site and change it. Okay, is that clear? Mutation is more like a perturbation. So when you change a bit, mostly if it takes place in the least significant bits, you're just slightly changing yourself.
Even if the string is infeasible, it could make it
feasible. It could make it feasible or the other way around. It can make it the other way around as well, yeah?
Can we perform this mutation before crossover?
You can. You can do. Either way, it's fine. But you don't want to do crossover and mutation before selection. Because you want to do selection first, so that crossover can take good solutions and exchange information.
Sir,
right?
Must we do crossover on that 6 samples?
Yes.
Okay, with probability say 80% or 70%.
Mm-hmm.
Then we do that.
Then you do mutation. Yeah. But what he's saying, you could do mutation first as well.
Then crossover.
Then crossover.
Mutation is very rare, so it will count between like.
Well, one bit per string is getting changed on an average. So it is not rare. Every string is getting mutated. No, you do every individual,
say
every iteration.
Probability is 10%, means I am changing just one sample.
No. Every sample is changed, and one bit in every sample is on an average changed. So mutation probability is usually 1 over the number of string length. So if it's 1 over the number of string length, on an average. So if you have 10 bits, I will use 0.1. So on an average, 1 will get changed. Then next string, again, 1 will change. Like that. You had a question?
Yes, sir. In the previous slide, probability of crossover. So, in the previous, of this, before this slide, we have a tournament selection within
right.
The category.
Mm-hmm.
So, there we are not going with a random search. Over
no.
Here, when we are crossing over,
right.
Waiting, we go for random. So
it's a random site. Again, it's a random number that is used,
yeah.
But the search is not random.
No.
Because, why is not random? If I have these two strings, if it were a random search, you could create any other string out of these two strings. Can rather 64 solutions out with 10 bits that you can only go to, and that subset is very little, maybe 8 or 16 strings that you can go to. So, and those strings are supposed to be the better ones because these are obtained by the selection operator. So, from the entire search space, selection is saying now that you have this. 6 solutions I have chosen, this represents only this part of this search space. And by recombination, you are staying in that part. You are not going far away from it. So it's far from being random.
That, my question is, that actually gets that line, which
mm-hmm.
we are dividing, whether that depends on the PC.
No. It doesn't depend on the PC, and these two separate things. First thing is, you flip a coin with PC. Let's say your PC is set to be 0.8. And you create a random number between 0 and 1. Say you get 0.35. Since it is less than 0.8, you will perform the crossover. If the random number was 0.92, it's greater than 0.8, so you will not do crossover. You will say, OK, I just send these two to mutation. So 80% of the time, you will be doing crossover, and 20% of the time, you will not be doing the crossover. After you've decided you will do crossover, then you create another random number between 0 to 9 or 1 to 9, saying which of the site that I'm going to do my crossover. So these two are independent events. So every pair of crossover is not crossed at the same site. Every time you create a new site, and then it's created. OK, we take a 5 minutes break because the tea is waiting outside. Okay.